on the models of communication. Let's get started. What I am going to do is I am going to share my screen with you. Can you all see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Good.
Yes, sir.
Very good. Okay, let's begin then. Let me hit the maximize button. All right. So today we are going to talk about, like, this is an introductory session related to models of communication. Give me a minute, please. I need to fix my camera. All right. So as you can see on my screen, my today's lecture is related to communication models. I'll take some intervals during my lecture. I'll take very brief pauses during my lecture only to go to the waiting room to see if there is anyone who wants to join. But for the rest of online classes, I recommend and I highly request you all to please join on time, because if you are coming late, then it is kind of a little distracting and disturbing for me. Today's lecture is essentially an introduction related to models of communication. And I'm going to ask you the same question that I asked my students this past week when I was briefly talking about models. So I would request you to recall any model that you may have read at any point in your life. And tell me, I'm going to ask this question, that how do you think how models are helpful in life? Like, you can think about any model that you may have read in a lecture related to mathematics, or in a book related to mathematics, or think about models in science, in chemistry, in think how do models help us? Even if you visit a mosque or a building, a historic building, at the entrance, sometimes they have a model that tells you, okay, here they have a prayer area, here they have area for wuzu, and models essentially tell us the whole structure in a very brief format. So I'm going to ask you, what do you think, how do models help us? Or how, in your experience, I'm essentially asking you to talk about your experience. Only two or three people. How do models help us? Come on, Faryal and Kamal Haider, Asad Raza, Aftab Jahanze. Just recall any model that you may have seen in any subject. How do models help us? Didn't you study Bohr's atomic model in sciences, in chemistry especially?
Ma'am?
Yes, go ahead please. Tell me your name and go ahead. Would anyone like to participate?
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am. My name is Ali Maris.
Go ahead, please.
Ma'am, models basically help us navigate through concepts and ideas and give us a very in-depth idea to what it stands for, what it actually means.
Shabash. May I know your name one more time?
Ali Maris.
Alima?
Yes, Alima.
Okay, very good, Alima. Yes. So Alima is saying that models help us navigate the whole thing, which means model help us understand what we are looking at. And if you ask me to talk about my perspective, I will say that in my experience, models help me simplify a structure. Let's say if I look at a model of a building, and I want to see, okay, where is prayer area? Let's say if I see at the model of an airport, in big airports, when you enter, usually you see the model, and I want to see, okay, where is terminal A, terminal B, terminal C, where are different concourses, where are different cafeterias, where is baggage drop area. So actually the model of an airport, what it is doing for me in this example is it is simplifying things for me. It helps me see where I can find certain areas. If I want to eat, which area should I go? If I want to say prayer, which area should I go? So in my experience, what models do for us is they kind of simplify things for us. That is what I would say if someone asks me what models do for you. With that, let's proceed to our second slide. Okay, so this is what I have said. What is a model? I was saying that models simplify things, but here on this screen, you can essentially see the description or a brief definition of a model. A model is a consciously simplified description in graphic form of a piece of reality. So there is something that exists in reality that exists out there. However, in the form of a model, you see that thing in simplified form. So let's talk about communication model. In communication, a communication is a process where we have many elements involved in it. So for example, right now we are engaging in communication. I am communicator and you are the destination. You are the ones to whom I am communicating my message. I am sender. In this particular example, I am the sender of the message. All of my students are receiver of my messages. So see, this is a process in this happening right now, the process of communication. In this process, we have a sender, we have a receiver, we have a medium that we are using right now, and that medium that we are using is this computer technology, internet, and PowerPoint and all that. So if I draw a structure where I write sender on one side, and then I write medium, which is internet, and then I write receivers on the other end, so it means message is going from sender through medium to receiver, which means I'm describing a process of communication in the form of a model. And this is what this first bullet says. So model is a consciously simplified description in graphic form of a piece of reality. When you are explaining things in the form of diagrams, in the form of graphs, in the form of sketches, diagrams, that is all what we say are models. What does a model do? It shows the main elements of any structure or process and the relationship between elements. This is, I think, these two bullets explain model really, really well. I'll take a pause for a minute and I'll rejoin again. All right. I hope you all can see my next slide. It talks about functions of model. It tells us what do models do for us. As you know that in this course, we will be discussing a lot of models. We will actually discuss theoretical practices. We will actually discuss theories, theoretical perspectives of the field of mass communication. So in this context, we are going to learn what do models do. Why do we have this need of coming up with models in communication? So models organize information. The biggest function that models perform in our lives is they organize information. They put things in order. They demonstrate relationships of different components. They let us perceive the whole. So there is this whole process. They let us see the whole process. For example, there is a complete, I think much more of this information that we are discussing today will become clearer to you when we actually proceed with other lectures, when we actually get to the discussion of models. And then last bullet here says that model also gives a general overview, a general picture of a phenomenon. In my experience, all of this is very self-explanatory. If you come across any question or if there is anything, any confusion, concern that comes in your mind, you should feel free to discuss it with me. With that, I'll stop here to ask you a question, and anyone can answer this question, anyone, whoever likes to. I request you all to please turn on your cameras and have them on all the time. Aftab, Amina, and then I have a couple more. Yeah, Quratul Ain has a problem. Yasir Iqbal, Salman Habib, Shiza Ali, please turn on your cameras, otherwise I'm not going to mark your attendance. Whoever has camera off, I'll not mark their attendance. All right. Now, I'm stopping my lecture here for a minute to ask you this question. And my question is that, can you recall any experience of studying any model in economics, in psychology, in biology, or any other subject? And can you relate it with the functions that you see here on the screen? That yes, I read this particular model in economics, and it helped me putting things in order. It helped me making the whole information organized, or any sort of experience that comes in your mind. Anyone? Alina or Aftab Jahanzeb or anyone?
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, yes. Go ahead, please.
Maths mein ek model hota tha, Pythagoras theorem ka. I don't know if it's a model or not.
It is. Good job. So, Pythagoras theorem.
Usme ye hota hai ki hypotenuse square is equal to base square plus perpendicular square.
Yes.
So we get a complete order of things. You need to follow that order.
Yeah. And sometimes they give you that in the form of a diagram as well. So isn't it base square is equal to perpendicular square plus hypotenuse, if I'm not mistaken. I have forgotten. I read the model a while ago. But yes, you are right. So Heather was saying that in maths, and all of us have studied this model in mathematics. I'm sure the model is taught at high school level. So in this model, it says, I mean, even if they show you the whole thing in the form of a picture, not only picture, the whole things in the form of an equation as well. And Heather just told us the equation. So don't you think in that model, things are put in order? Don't you think not only they are in order, they also tell us the relationship. Like if two of the components in a triangle are added, you can get answer for the third one. Don't you think? Similarly, okay. But anyways, let me go to my last slide. This is where I was. All right, so we're talking about functions of model, and in last slide we learned that models put things in order for us. They organize pieces of information for us. Here's the second function. Models explain by providing a simple information which would otherwise be difficult. So there are, I'll pause here to ask you another simple question. And this is for today, this is going to be my last slide, because I'm going to spend this whole week talking about different functions of model. And we'll talk about the rest of the components of this slide in our coming lectures, in our lecture on Wednesday. But here, I want to ask you a question, and I would like you all to participate. My question is, listen to this carefully, and I'll give you 2 minutes to think about the answer of this question. And then whoever raises the hand, I'll ask the answer from that person. My question is that, is communication a complex process? If so, how? Similarly, those of you who say no, communication is not a complex process, it's a simple process, from them I would again like to ask the reasons. I will repeat my question. My question is communication a complex process or a complex phenomena? If so, how? This is the question that I wanted to ask. Take 2 minutes to think about it. Okay. Alima has raised her hand. Alima, just give me a couple minutes with it. Let others finish their working, and then we will proceed with you. Okay? Better you haven't named yourselves. I request that when you join this online class next time, please put your names along with your picture so that I can see whenever you raise your hand, I can know your name. I can know who wants to speak. All right. We will begin. Alima was the one who raised the hand first, so I'll begin with her. And then there is another person. Bete, there's another person. There are two more persons who have raised their hands. May I know your names?
Ma'am, Faryal.
Faryal, okay. Bete, tell me your name. Another person, Hubab. Theek hai. Hubab and okay. Let's begin with Alima. Yes, Alima.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, I believe that communication is a complex phenomena because the way we communicate in different forms using models as well, not everyone can comprehend all of it in the same way. So when we try to convey our message even through using visual graphics or using words or anything to communicate, it's difficult for us to interpret who will comprehend it in which way. So it is a complex phenomena because we have to see how everybody will do it and then apply different kinds of theories and aspects to it for every other person.
So what Alima is saying is that my understanding of what you have said is that each person is different and different people apply in different ways. And this diversity is something that makes the process of communication difficult. Is this what you were saying, Alima?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And the medium of instruction we use mainly for our models.
Okay.
Like good. If it's in English, not everybody can understand English. So we'll have to do it in Urdu as well for the people who live in rural areas. Different diversities. Yes, ma'am.
Good. Good. Okay. Yes, Faryal.
Yes, ma'am. I think communication is a complex process because when it comes to communicating, there are a lot of aspects to one thing. For example, if we're trying to communicate emotions, there are so many aspects to a single emotion that sometimes it just gets lost and we can't get through to the receiver as nicely as we intend to. So sometimes it is a very complex process.
Okay. What Faryal has said is that it is a process that has a lot of aspects related to it. But you haven't elaborated on aspects. What aspects you are referring to?
For example, ma'am, when I talk about emotions, there are always many things that I can't really explain. Can I just have 1 minute?
Sure. All right. And then there is another person. There was another person who wanted to take part. Can you please start speaking? I think her name was Hubab.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I think that it is a complex procedure as we have to find the right medium to communicate. And if we do not have the right medium, we cannot really say what we want to say. And the person who is at the receiving end would not get our message.
Very good. This is a very good point. Anyone else? Is there anyone else? Would like to participate? Good job, girls. Okay, let me sum it up. First, Alima spoke and she talked about the idea of diversity of opinion. It is true. Each person is different. Each person would be communicating with a different standpoint. So that is something that adds to the diversity of communicators, and that is something that makes the process of communication a bit complex. But and then Faryal said that communication is a concept that has a lot of aspects involved to it, although she didn't elaborate, but I will elaborate it shortly, just in a moment. And then Hubab said that it is a difficult process because in order to communicate effectively, we have to think about the choice of our medium, what medium we are choosing, because it's our medium that is going to make our communication successful. With that, I would like to ask you one thing. Do you all agree that communication is a complex process? Or is there anyone who says, no, it is not complex, it is quite simple? So are we all on the same page when we say that communication is a complex process? I think all of us say that communication is a complex process. Let me explain it now. How is communication a complex process? Well, let me go back to my slide. Yeah, this is where I was. Okay, communication is a complex process, yes. Communication is a process that has many elements, many components involved in it, just like Faryal said. She used the word aspects. She said that aspect, it has a process that has aspects involved in it, aspects attached to it. By aspects, I think my understanding is that she meant to say components. Let's imagine a process of communication happening. Let's imagine a show or a movie that you are watching on Netflix. Just take that example. That is a process of communication happening. There is a sender, probably the producer, the director who has produced the movie. And then there is a channel that they are using. And that channel in this case is Netflix. And then there are receivers. You are not the only person who is receiving, who is watching the movie. There are a number of other people involved in this process. Mass audience. Communication is happening at a mass level. What is mass communication? Mass communication is communicating with masses. And this is what we do in mass communication. So see how many components are involved in it. How many aspects are involved? There is sender, there is medium of communication, like Hubab said, and then there are masses who are receiving, of course, with possible effects. Have you ever been affected by a movie emotionally, let's say, or in terms of behavioral effect? We all, by the way, are affected by advertisements. Have advertisements ever affected you in a way that they have made you buy a product or change your choice? Let's say you use Jazz cell phone service and you are quite comfortable with it, you are very satisfied with it, but after watching a particular advertisement, you want to switch your choice, you want to change your choice, you want to switch to Varid service, let's say, or Uphone service. Has it ever happened to you? Has it ever happened to anyone in this class?
Yes ma'am.
See, so again, this is a process that is coming with effects as well. Earlier, I was talking about an example of Netflix, and I said that it's a complex process because it has many elements involved in it. It has sender, it has receiver, it has a medium, and then we see that it is a process that also comes with effects. So a process that has so many components attached to it, that has so many aspects involved in it, cannot be a simple process. For this very reason, we need to understand communication as a process. And in order to understand, we use models to make the complex process simple, to comprehend it, to make sense of it, to understand it so that we can then talk about predictions, we can talk about solutions, and we can talk about many other things that are involved. And this is what I have written on this slide. See? Models explain by providing a simple information which would otherwise be difficult. We're talking about this idea that communication is a complex process. However, models are something that make this process simple and easy. And you will get more understanding when we start discussing our models. Okay. Now, third point that you see on screen, it says models have heuristic function. Does anyone know what is the meaning of heuristic? Okay, let me explain. And I request you to pay attention to this. Heuristic means let someone learn by himself or herself, or let people learn by themselves. Which means if I show you a model, let's talk about Pythagoras model that was just suggested by one of your class fellows, Heather. So when you look at Pythagoras theorem, it says, Heather, remind me, what is Pythagoras theorem? Is it base square is equal to hypotenuse plus perpendicular?
Hypotenuse square is equal to base square plus perpendicular square.
Okay. So it says hypotenuse square is equal to base square plus perpendicular square. Is that correct, Heather? Okay. Heuristic means, I was saying that the meaning of heuristic is that you let someone learn by himself or herself. When I show this model, let's say to a high school student without teaching him the model, just by looking at the equation, just by looking at the diagram, he can make sense of what he is seeing. That is heuristic function. When you let people learn things on their own, heuristic. Does that make sense? Can anyone repeat this for me? I just want to make sure that you have grasped this idea of heuristic.
Ma'am, can you please repeat this again?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Can you please repeat this again?
I'm sorry?
Ma'am, can you please repeat this again?
Sure, I can. I sure can. Can you tell me your name?
Ma'am, Talal.
Okay, Talal. Heuristic ka matlab hai, the meaning of heuristic is to let people learn by themselves. Like you show them a picture, you show them a model, you show them a structure, and you let them learn by themselves. This is one function of model. You show them a complicated thing and you let them learn by themselves. This is what we mean by heuristic function. And we were talking about Pythagoras theorem. We said that Pythagoras theorem comes in the form of an equation and it comes in the form of a diagram as well. The equation of Pythagoras theorem says that hypotenuse square is equal to base square plus perpendicular square. If I show this equation, let's say to a 10th grade student or a 9th grade student, and I do not teach him Pythagoras theorem, I just show him the equation. By just looking at the equation, he can make sense of what Pythagoras theorem is. So what do you think? If I present you an equation of Pythagoras theorem, is that going to be more understandable, or reading Pythagoras theorem in the form of an information that comes in paragraph? Is the second example going to be more understandable? Is the first example more understandable or second example more understandable? Which one is more understandable?
Ma'am, the first one.
The first one, because it comes in the form of an equation. Very good. So this is what we mean by heuristic function of model. I'm running out of time. I have only 10 minutes left for this class. I will quickly wrap up this session, and I want to save last 5 minutes for your question and answer as well. Fourth point says that models help us predict events. By looking at models, you can predict the process. Okay, this is what is happening and this is where the situation may lead to. So idea is that models help us predict things. Models actually increase the possibility of prediction. This is how, these are some of the functions that models perform for us. Students, today after I end the lectures on Moodle, I'm going to upload a recording of this session. With that, I'm also going to upload PowerPoint notes of the chapter. This is 15-page document chapter. You should read it by the end of this week. And I'm also going to upload a copy of these slides. I'm going to stop sharing my screen with you. When I say that I'll be uploading lectures, recorded lectures, it does not mean that you do not show up in lectures. I highly recommend that you attend lectures, take part in conversation, because recording is only for those people who sometimes cannot join sessions because of connectivity issues, if that makes sense. If your power goes out, if you have bad internet or something, then you shouldn't worry about missing lecture, because it will be, of course, available on Moodle. But with that, I would also like to say that this is just a support that we are providing. This is not a substitute for your lectures. Like being in the real time of a class setting is a totally different learning experience. It is quite enriching. For this very reason, I highly recommend that you do not miss your lectures. All right, now I would ask questions if you have any.
Ma'am, aapne attendance mark kar liye?
I'll do that now.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Sure, go ahead, please.
Ma'am, what I comprehended from today's class was that for a communication model to work, we need a visual representation, like the Pythagoras theorem. We need the concept there in form of a diagram or any other display. So what if the person we're trying to communicate the model to is visually impaired? So how are we going to compensate that model for that person? Like I talked about diversity, that not everybody can comprehend it in the same way.
I think this is a very good question, Alima. We have all different sorts of aids for people who are visually impaired or people who have visual impairment or hearing problem and that kind of thing. So for that, of course, they rely on the tools that are specifically for them. But models are generally for everyone. So for I mean, you know, people who are visually impaired, they have their own sort of books that they can, where they can feel words by touching and everything. So the same way, we have models written in a style that are specific for them, and by, of course, and they can make meaning of the information that is provided to them. This reminds me of a person who had this problem. Last week I presented at a workshop at a doctoral school that happened in Islamabad. All PhD students were participating in it. And there was a person who could not see. And he was also participating in that workshop. And whenever I would start my lecture, he would ask me to tell him beforehand so that he could begin his recording. So you see, he was having all these sort of tools that were helping him to, of course, overcome this shortcoming that he had. Does that answer your question, Alima?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Okay, this was just an introductory lecture related to models of communication. Of course, things will start becoming a bit complex as we move toward the actual discussion of models in our next lectures. So this week I want to spend time for a discussion related to models of communication. Probably for our class on Friday, I'll assign you an activity. I'll finish this lecture on Wednesday, and for our class on Friday, I'm going to assign you an activity. Does that make sense? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Which will be related to models again. And then soon after that, from next week, we will actually begin from the discussion of models, the actual models. And the first model that we are going to discuss next week is Laswell's model. I'm going to write about the model in the chat box. Okay, this is the, sorry, it's going to just one person. This is the model that we are going to discuss next. Take care. All right, do you have any question? If you do not, I'm going to stop.